Allah is my heart's speech. Your mercy is what I beseech. Keep in my heart your remembrance, and in your deen allow me to advance. Help me in my quest. Permit me to pass the ultimate test. Help me in my quest. Permit me to pass the ultimate test. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله وكفى وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى لا سيما المصطفى صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. I praise Allah the Almighty alone, and I send the best peace and blessings upon all His prophets, particularly Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Dear viewers everywhere, welcome to a new edition of Ask Huda. Our phone numbers beginning with the area code 002-0100-246-4583. Alternatively, there is another number, 002-0112-500-8679. And email address or addresses is ask@huda.tv and alternatively gardens@huda.tv. Barakallahu feekum. I tried my best to answer most of the questions yesterday, alhamdulillah, but I figured that there is still a couple of pending questions. Sister Aisha from the KSA, she said, I prayed witr once in the mosque and once at home. Is this okay? I figured that we also talked about this, that An-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, La witrani fi layla. We should not pray to witr in the same night, because if we do, then by the end we didn't get to pray witr. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith, Salatul layli masna masna, you should pray at night two by two. That is the ideal format. Then if you fear dawn, if you fear the appearance of al-fajr, then fa'awtar, pray the witr, even if it is just one rak'ah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum, Sister Ummu Muhammad from United Arab Emirates.
Hello, assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to Ask Huda.
Ramadan Mubarak, inshaAllah.
Barakallahu fiki. Thank you so much.
Sheikh, I have more than three, but if you don't allow me, I can go.
Go ahead, go ahead.
I put the important one first.
No.
I have a property which I have put on sale for 7% premium. The lady has found a customer. And then she told me I have put 8% because he's a very good investor of us, and we cannot charge him 2% commission. Mm. So we charge him 1%, and then you give us 1%.
Mm.
Now, is it permissible? Is it haram? Because the guy would not know that this 1% is to them.
Okay, but
my question number.
Yeah, Ummu Muhammad. Ummu Muhammad.
Question number two is. Regarding, we have a night guard for tooth which we put at night. It's like a plastic which protects the teeth from biting. And normally if you don't put it, which I had problem, you get cracked in the teeth and it breaks. It's not so serious if it goes for long maybe. So I'm having it normally, but in Ramadan I don't put it because I think it's plastic and you're swallowing over plastic. So I avoid during the Ramadan. But I feel, I'm feeling better, so maybe. And maybe it could cause this breakup, or if it's not so serious. Is it allowed to put this during the Ramadan at night? Because you will have it the whole night in your mouth. And my third question is regarding, I had a hajj before 5-6 years ago, where I had a new toothbrush with me there. And I felt little bleeding, not bleeding, spot of bleed when I was using it, because it was new, and you know, normally it is sore on the gum. So I asked somebody there, he said, no, inshallah, maqbool, and I didn't do slaughtering. So is it necessary to do it? Because for me, slaughtering is not an issue. I can do sadaqah anyway, and if it is better, I can go ahead for poor people and do it now, if I feel better. Can I go ahead more?
Ummu Muhammad, can you hear me now? Sister Ummu Muhammad. Okay, it seems like you can hear me. Okay, go ahead and continue, please.
Okay, okay, my next question is regarding dead people. Two more questions anyway. It's a quick question. Regarding dead people, what is the best to do? To build a masjid for them, which is good. I know for living people, or just sadaqah or do umrah or hajj for them. And my last question, can I have somebody do hajj on behalf of myself? Because normally it's very difficult. I have done 5 umrah and hajj, but it's very difficult now. I'm not getting relatives, men to come with me and purify, you know, our soul and whatever, forgiveness.
No.
Can I do maybe every year or if it's allowed for living people?
طيب بارك الله فيك.
As I heard for dead people only, not allowed something like that, or allowed for both.
Thank you, Umm Muhammad. بارك الله فيك. Sister Umm Ammar from Jordan is next on the line. Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to Ask Huda.
Wa alaikum salam. How are you?
I'm fine, alhamdulillah. Thank you for asking.
Yeah. I actually wanted to ask, we attend Quran classes here in Jordan, and we have a friend who's an Ahmadi. And I wanted to know, is it possible, should we meet her and eat her food? Is her food okay with us? Can we eat her food? Is it permissible? And also, can we meet her often, and how much friendship can we keep with her?
Okay. Okay, thank you, Umm Ammar. Okay. Sister Umm Muhammad from United Arab Emirates asked about a property for sale, and the agent or the real estate agent is taking a percentage or charging a certain percentage. I'm not sure whether she said 2 or more or less. It doesn't really matter, and whether this is permissible or not. If both the buyer and the seller are aware of that, and there are no checks, no hiddens, that's perfectly fine. And that's why the realtor or the real estate agent has an office, or if he doesn't have an office, he takes upon himself the responsibility of marketing your property and selling it. So he takes a commission on that based on the pre-agreement. Sometimes the real estate agents charge only the seller, or sometimes they only charge the buyer, whatever. As long as there are no hiddens, because the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من غش فليس منا, and he forbade الغرر في البيع. الغرر is deceiving, or if there is anything which is not clear, that would invalidate, if it is something major, invalidate the whole transaction. And he said in the earlier hadith that I mentioned, one who cheats is not one of us, he does not belong to us. And that was mentioned in the transaction. Whenever he saw a merchant, he was selling dates in the market. So he put his hand in the date container and he found witness on the bottom. He said, what is it? He said, أصابته السماء. It rained, so the precipitation settled in the bottom. And you know that when the dates are wet, the quality get lesser. And also, the prices will be lesser. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if this is the case, even though he did not do it deliberately, why don't you separate the dry from the wet, and you sell this with a certain price and the other with a certain price, so the buyer knows what he's buying, because he sees on top the dry, he assumes everything is like that. Okay? I have seen in one country, I went to buy a watermelon, which looked extremely red. Very beautiful watermelon. So I said, I want one like this. He said, we don't have one like this. I said, why not? I figured that he painted it. He painted the watermelon with red paint so that it would look like very bright red. That's called cheating and deceiving and earning from such transaction. And this is a very simple thing, because you made me assume that your goods are all like that. So I bought with this intention. Then I go home and I find the rotten one, and I find the soft one, not the dry one. This is haram. من غشى فليس منا. One who cheats, deceives, does not belong to us. This is not an Islamic behavior. But as I said in the beginning, if you all agree to the percentage of the commission, no problem. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sister Layla from the KSA.
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. How are you? Welcome to the program.
I have a question, Sheikh. I have a gold amount zakatable, but we just bought it a few months ago.
No.
Do we have to pay zakat for it?
Okay. When you bought it, you
one
bought
more thing, Sheikh. I've been sending an email to support Huda, but I'm not getting any reply. Is there any other way I can give the support, because they are not sending reply?
Can you deposit your email address in the control? Inshallah, and I will have them contact you. If you can hear
okay.
me. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Sister Umm Abdullah from Qatar. Sister Umm Abdullah, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. How are you?
I'm fine, alhamdulillah. Barakallah fiki. Go ahead.
Sheikh, I have three questions. The first one is regarding the last 10 days of Ramadan. Is woman allowed to observe itikaf in the mosque?
Okay.
My second question is regarding if a woman gets married, I know quite a lot is forbidden for her to change her name to her husband's name. But these days, I observe some women, they took their father's name, but they now add their husband's name to their name. Is that permissible in Islam?
Okay. Thank you, Sister Umm Abdullah. Barakallahu fiqh. Sister Umm Muhammad from United Arab Emirates was performing Hajj a couple of years ago, and she was using a toothbrush and she bled. That doesn't affect the Hajj, doesn't affect the fasting, doesn't affect the Ihram whatsoever. So you do not owe a kafara or a ransom or even seeking a particular forgiveness for this, because it is not a sin. Bleeding from an injury does not invalidate your Ihram, your Hajj or Umrah. Okay? What are the things which would benefit the dead ones? Many things. Number one, and on top of the list, is making dua for the dead ones. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after burying one of his companions, said to the rest of the companions, "Istaghfiru li akhikum fa innahu al-ana yus'al." Seek forgiveness for your brother, since he will be questioned right now. So that indicated that the dua would benefit the dead. Ibrahim alayhi salam, Nuh alayhi salam, has been reported in the Quran, رب اغفر لي ولوالدي ولمن دخل بيتي مؤمنا وللمؤمنين والمؤمنات رب اغفر لي ولوالدي وللمؤمنين والمؤمنات etc. So these invocations in the Quran help us to comprehend that we are actually encouraged and recommended to make dua for our late parents and grandparents and our teachers and those whom we know and those whom we do not know of the dead Muslims. لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ. For everybody, as long as they were believers. Giving in a charity also would definitely help them performing Hajj or Umrah in their state, feeding the poor people, giving iftar to people during Ramadan, and gifting the thawab or the reward to the dead people. All of that is guaranteed, inshallah, to benefit them. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sister Umm Fahd from the KSA. Assalamu alaikum. Sister Umm Fahd, can you hear me?
Hello, yes.
Naam, go ahead, please.
Yes, assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi.
I have two questions.
Yes, go ahead.
One is regarding usher. According to my knowledge, usher on land irrigated by wells, etc., is 5% and is to be given on the total yield, and all the expenses are to be paid after. Now, in present times, when the cost of cultivation has soared because of the prices of fertilizers, diesel, electricity, and pesticides, etc., if a crop is good, almost on average 50% of the value of the crop goes in covering the expenses. But if the crop is not good, then the cost can go much higher in percentage, and sometimes it barely covers the cost. In such scenario, how will the usher be calculated? Because if the usher is paid first, then the farmer settles all his bills. He will be left with a bare minimum or nothing to survive upon.
Okay.
So, question number one is this.
Yeah.
Second, the zakat on the crop of sugarcane, potatoes, rice, and corn. Will it be calculated like wheat or barley, or like 2.5% of the profit? And another question is regarding fasting. In places like Norway, where the duration of a fast is 19 to 20 hours these days, what is the ruling for someone who is finding it difficult to cope with the fast on a regular basis, though a normal and healthy person?
Okay. Thank you, sister Mufahd. But the Ush means 1/10 is not 1/5. And inshallah, we'll elaborate on that inshallah when I come to answer your question. Thank you. Brother Rashid from the KSA is next on the line. Assalamu alaikum, Brother Rashid.
Rasul Abbas.
Rasul. Assalamu alaikum, Brother Rasul. Naam, go ahead.
Aywa. Alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullah.
Naam, go ahead.
I want to ask something.
I won't be able to take your question before you mute your TV, please.
Regarding this Salatul Tasbih.
Convey the message to him, please. Naam, now you can talk.
Salatul Tasbih.
Naam.
I want to ask if it is okay or not.
Excuse me.
Hello?
I got your question. Thank you, Rasul. Okay. Thank you. I think if you randomly click on any Ask Huda episode on the YouTube, you will find a question about Salatul Tasabih. This is how often that people ask about Salatul Tasabih. Subhanallah. Sister Muhammad wants to perform Hajj. She's done Hajj several times and Umrah, but she's kind of tired, or, you know, can she ask somebody else to perform Hajj in her stead? Since Alhamdulillah, you performed your own Hajj, Hajjatul Fariidah, Hajjatul Islam, and you performed several Hajj afterward, let me suggest to you something that you can do with this money. Send somebody who did not perform Hajj at all to perform his or her Hajj, Hajjatul Islam, and you will get the same reward. So this way, you hit two birds with one stone. Because if Alhamdulillah, you're alive and you are able to perform Hajj, you cannot send somebody on your behalf, even if you're tired. But since Allah blessed you and you performed several Hajj, with this money, you can send somebody. Or there are many means you can utilize this money. For instance, if I know orphan girls who are about to get married, I would prepare them for marriage with this kind of money. What really matters is how the money is invested in any righteous deed. And I believe this is a priority. So since Alhamdulillah you performed your Hajj, either you sponsor somebody's Hajj and you will get the same reward inshallah. Since the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Ad-dallu ala al-khayri kafa'ilih." In another narration, "Lahu ajru fa'ilih." Lahu mithlu ajri fa'ilih. The one who guides to righteousness would get the same exact reward or a similar reward in different narrations of the person who does it. Sister Umm Ammar from Jordan, she has an Ahmadi woman in her class, and she was asking if she can eat her food and hang around with her. Do you know what Ahmadi means to begin with? This is a very important thing. This is something that we have to be aware of. Ahmadi is a sect which is not from Islam. It is perfectly okay for any person, even for one who is worshipping idols, to say he's a believer. Yeah, he believes in his idol. I don't care. But we're talking about what Islam is all about. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأن محمد رسول الله ولكن رسول الله وخاتم النبيين. And he's the last prophet. You have an issue with that, okay, you're out of the boundaries of Islam. Qadianis, Ahmadis, who came to me in the States and they wanted to teach their children the Quran, I said, what for? Okay? I want to learn the Quran. Well, first you're going to learn Iman. You're going to learn what is the meaning of Islam. If you're willing to do that, we'll teach you both. And we'll sit and we'll talk and we'll explain to you if there is any confusion. But you want to learn the Quran like some sects. Just they want to learn how to read the Quran to appear as Muslims. No. If the sister says, I believe that Allah is the only God who is worthy of worship, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was his last messenger, and she has some confusions, we'll be more than happy to clarify that to her and refute any misconception. But if she's firm in her belief that there was a prophet after Muhammad or whatever, I know. Thank you so much. She's not even supposed to be attending the class with you. I know it might seem or sound harsh, but this is how it is. I don't mind a non-Muslim coming to my center or to my class and say, I want to learn about Islam. I want to learn about the deen, what Islam is all about. I'll be more than happy to do that. But why you want to learn how to read the Quran? Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sister Ummu Ahmed from the KSA. Sister Ummu Ahmed, assalamu alaikum.
Yeah, welcome, Islam. Sheikh, how are you?
Alhamdulillah, I'm fine. Barakallahu fiki.
Sheikh, I want to ask two questions, please.
Yeah.
Hello?
I'm listening, Sister Ummu Ahmed. Proceed on, please.
Hello?
Naam, assalamu alaikum.
Yeah, welcome, Islam. My first question is about traveling. I'm from Pakistan, but I'm living in Saudi Arabia. So whenever I go to Pakistan for a short vacation, about 1 week or 2 weeks, I have a house over there. So I have to pray kasr, or should I pray the full prayers?
Okay, and that is your house, right?
Yeah, we have a house in Pakistan.
And this is going to be your family there?
Sorry?
And your family will be there?
I'm sorry, I'll say it again.
Okay, that's okay. How long are you staying in Pakistan?
Well, we usually go for 10 days.
10 days, okay. In any case, for 10 days, you should pray the regular prayer, along with the nawafil as well. Barakallah.
Pray regularly?
Yes, you pray regularly. You're not eligible to shorten the prayer because you're exceeding the time span, which is 4 days. Okay? Barakallah fiki, Sister Umm Ahmed. Sister Asia from the KSA, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum
as-salam,
rahmatullahi barakatuh. How are you, Sheikh?
Alhamdulillah, I'm fine. Thank you for asking, Sister Asia.
Jazakallah khair. Sheikh, I just want some comment and advice from you. There is a common culture from expatriates of Asian countries living in Middle East countries. They invite for iftar with grand parties, presentations with more than 8 dishes. The preparation starts two, three days before, while the visitors after the fast can hardly consume so many dishes. All is either kept aside or kept in a fridge for more than 3-4 days for the people who invited to eat at home. Mm. The more they are unable to do the worship in presentation in preparation of all these dishes. Mm. When they come to the parties, they hardly talk about the deen. They talk about the dunya, and that also in the month of Ramadan. I ask them to keep such a parties not in Ramadan, so that. But they say that we cannot invite for iftar is a charity. But they only invite the famous people and the people which are labeled to them, not the poor people. Mm. Is this acceptable? Please advise.
Right. Thank you, Sister Asya. Barakallahu fiki. Sister Layla from the KSA, she purchased an amount of gold recently, and now she's asking, does she have to pay zakah on that gold? Okay, let's put it this way. You have 50 grand, which you normally pay the zakah on it during the month of Ramadan. Let's say in the middle of Ramadan. Then during the month of Sha'ban, you took 20 grand out of the 50 and you bought some gold. So now the actual cash with you is 30. What about the gold? Worth 20. You still pay zakah on the entire amount. Whether you bought it a day before or in middle of the period of the lunar year, because this is like cash, exactly. Whether you bought it recently or from old, what happened is you add up everything that you actually possess in any form or shape beyond your need, whether for saving or investment. Saving or investment. We know that Al-Imam Abu Hanifa is of the view that we should pay zakah on gold and silver, on jewelry, even if it is used for adornment. While Al-Jumhur are of the view that if the woman is wearing her jewelry on a regular basis, it's like her own clothes. She doesn't have to pay zakah on that. So if you choose whichever opinion and you're happy with it, khalas. But one who's trying to skip the payment of zakah by turning some cash into the form of gold and silver, you have to keep in mind that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in ayah number 103 of Surah At-Tawbah, خُذْ مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ صَدَقَةً تُطَهِّرُهُمْ وَتُزَكِّيهِمْ بِهَا وَصَلِّ عَلَيْهِمْ إِنَّ صَلَاتَكَ سَكَنٌ لَهُمْ. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, take a part of their wealth as a charity in order to purify them with it, to sanctify their house with it, to purify their wealth with it. So that is the purpose of a zakah, purification of wealth, of one's wealth and one's heart. So if the person tries to do any trick to skip the payment of zakah, he is a loser. I do not necessarily address you with this talk. Rather, I'm just speaking in general. Because some people may do things like that, approaching the payment of zakah, especially the multimillionaires who have plenty of wealth. And they look at the amount of zakah, oh wow, do I have to pay like a half million in zakah? Yes. Don't look at the amount which you're paying, which is 2.5%. Look at what you have. Allah has blessed you with all of that. That is malullahi alladhi atakum. That is Allah's wealth which He entrusted you with. And He only asks you to take out of every 100, 2.5. Bas. So one has to look at it this way. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brother Sharif from United Arab Emirates. Assalamu alaikum.
I'm Sheikh, how are you?
I'm fine, alhamdulillah. Barakallah feek, Brother Sharif.
Sheikh, I would like to ask two questions, please.
Naam. Go ahead, Brother Sharif, I'm listening to you.
Sheikh, I just wanted to ask, the first question is that once I was in a foreign country looking for a mosque to pray my Jummah, and I ended up going to Ahmadiyya Mosque, which I was not aware of the caste and how what these people do at that point of time. And I prayed my prayer behind these people and the Jamaat. So after I left the mosque, I did some, I was not feeling comfortable in the mosque and the speech they gave, so I had some feeling about it. And then I came out and I checked with my friends, and they said this Nadia group of people, they described it to me what they are and what they believe in. So I had a regret about what I did. So, and I just wanted to know whether my prayer was accepted on that occasion or not. Or
no,
should I
it was not accepted.
Again?
You need
that's
to redo.
Question.
Okay.
And,
can you hear me?
The second question is that my father is. He's quite old. He's 74 years old, and he has some illnesses as well. He has some infection from lungs, in the lungs, and he's asthmatic as well. He tries to keep his fast, but sometimes he's forced to break it, and sometimes he's not able to fast. This has been happening for a few years now. I just want to know that is there a kufara for him? Is there anything that I can do on his behalf? If he has missed all the fasting, or he would miss any fast in the future as well. He doesn't have any source of income, so what is your opinion on that one, please? That's my question. And jazakallah khair.
Wa jazakum barakallah feek. Sister Ummu Amn from the KSA. Assalamu alaikum, Sister Umm Amin.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh.
Ramadan Mubarak, and Jazakallahu khairan for that chat, for that from South Korea.
Barakallahu feek.
I have two questions. My first question is, if I'm going to the mosque for congregational prayers, for instance in Mecca and Medina, and the prayer has already started, then up to what point can I join the prayer without having to make up for missing a rakah? And my second question is, if I've missed the first two rakahs, and then I join the prayer, and then I make up for the missed rakahs after the taslim, would I need to recite a portion of the Quran after the Fatiha when I make up for these first two missed rakahs?
I got it. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sister Amn. We'll take a short break, and inshallah we'll be back in a couple of minutes. Please stay tuned.
essence of Islam, Tawheed, believing in the oneness of Allah, the same message that Allah sent all His prophets with since the beginning of time.
La ilaha illallah. You need Tawheed. Especially at the time of distress, at the time of need.
Tawheed first with Imam Kareem Abu Zayd in Ramadan only on Huda TV.
Ramadan is here.
We're only a few sunsets away from the month of change, an opportunity that is given to us only once a year. Take a look at this. Take a look at your future. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. It's a very windy and dusty day here. We're about an hour out of Cairo in the middle of the desert. Al-ikhlas, sincerity. Whether you are alone in the middle of the ocean, in a boat, or on a river, or in a busy city street, your only way to success in this life and the next is through sincerity. Methanol, which is the fuel that is used for rockets, that is placed inside cigarettes, that we're putting into our bodies when we're breaking our fast. Subhanallah. Together, let's plant the seeds of change.
أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله.
I bear witness that none has the right to be worshipped except Allah, alone without partner, and I bear witness that Muhammad is His slave and messenger. Muhammad, peace be upon him, our ultimate role model.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back. Sister Umm Abdullah from Qatar. Can a woman perform i'tikaf? Yes, the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the lady companions used to perform i'tikaf during his life and afterwards. So i'tikaf is also permissible for women. A woman who carries or bears her husband's name, even along with her dad's name, that is not permissible. أدعوهم لآبائهم هو أقسط عند الله. Your husband's name or last name should not intervene with your name. Your name is the name that your parents gave you. Your last name likewise, Fatima bint Muhammad ibn Ibrahim ibn Kada. Then you stick to that. Your husband have nothing to do with your name. This is a non-Islamic tradition, and it comes in a clear violation with the prohibition of doing such thing in the Quran in Surah Al-Ahzab. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brother Abdul Halim from the KSA.
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
How are you, sir?
I'm fine.
Shahar Mubarak to you.
Barakallahu feek. Thank you so much.
Shahar Mubarak to you.
Barakallahu feek.
Sheikh, I want to ask one question to you. I have to pay zakat, and my hometown, they are building one mosque. There is only one mosque, and people in the community are not that well off to build their own. So can I pay zakat money to build up that mosque in hometown?
Okay. Thank
Hello?
You. Yeah, I got your question, Brother Abdul Halim. Any other questions?
No, good.
Okay, thank you. Appreciate it. Brother Muhammad from Qatar is next on the line. Assalamu alaikum. Muhammad, assalamu alaikum, Brother Muhammad.
Hello.
Yeah, wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum. Type, try again because we are in a hurry. We have very, very short time, mashallah. May Allah bless us in this very short time and make it a long and a blessed time. Ameen. Sister Mufahd from the KSA, she asked about the ushr on the cultivated land. You know, there is a program which inshallah will benefit you a great deal, which is called Fiqh of Zakah. I recorded with Brother Jamil Rashid, I believe. It's available also on our website and on YouTube for free. Where I talked about the ushr and nisf al-ushr. Al-ushr means 1/10. Al-ardu al-ushriya is the cultivated land which is irrigated by the rain water. So you're not making any effort. You just sow the seeds and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends down the rain and it produces either grains or fruits which can be either weighed, measured or stored. So vegetables, there is no zakat on vegetables whatsoever. But as you say, potatoes and corn and grains, yes, zakatable. If the land was irrigated, the cultivated land was irrigated via using a machine, then the zakah will be half. Nisf al-ushr, which is 1/5. Al-ushr means 1/10, and nisf al-ushr is 1/5. And rub' al-ushr is 2.5%, that is on wealth, investment, and saving. But for the land, the cultivated land, if it has been irrigated normally by the rainwater, then 1/10, because he didn't do much. 1/10 of what? Of the actual produce. Before even calculating the effort and the laborers and pain, 1/10 of the actual produce. Al-khums, nusful ushr, is before also calculating any expenses. So if you've used machines and electricity and power and all of that to cultivate your land and irrigate it, then what you owe is only 1/5 of the produce. It must be given in a charity to the poor. According to Al-Imam Abu Hanifa, which we feel very comfortable with this opinion, there is no certain nisab. It doesn't matter how much is the quantity which you harvest from the cultivated land, whether it's a lot or a little, as long as it is hubub or thimar, right away there is zakah on it, other al-ushr or nisf al-ushr, as I explained earlier. Nor is there any hawl, because we know that in the cultivation, it's seasonal. Some grain, some thimar may take a month, couple months. It doesn't take a year. Okay, so once you harvest the produce, you give the zakah right away. Thank you, Sister Umm Shahd. Brother Muhammad from Qatar, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum salam, Sheikh. How are you? Ramadan Kareem to you and your family, Sheikh.
Barakallah feek. Thank you so much. May Allah bless you and your family.
Sheikh, I have a question regarding the payment of zakat.
Naam. Okay? If we lost that call, please try again, Brother Muhammad from Qatar. It's a zakah season. Brother Suhail from Oman. Assalamu alaikum.
Hello.
Assalamu alaikum.
Yeah, assalamu alaikum.
Alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
I just want to know about regarding interest. Because nowadays, because of economic condition of money, the value is going to be devalued.
Now.
And the second thing is government also want taxes over our earnings.
So what is the question?
So for compensation of these conditions, can we use interest provided by banks, saving accounts, where we are not exploiting any poor person?
No, you can't. Interest is haram. Usually is haram. You can simply buy gold if you want and save your gold.
Yeah.
So if the value increases, it increases with it. And if it decreases, you encounter the loss as well. But if you deposit your money in a saving account or in a conventional bank with a fixed interest rate, that is the typical riba or usury. Barakallah feek, Suhail. Thank you so much. Brother Rasul from the KSA, with Salatu Tasabih. Salatul Tasabih has been mentioned in a hadith by Al-Abbas, who is the Prophet's uncle, with a very unique setup of how to pray it, unique format, that I spoke about it very, very oftenly. And Al-Jumhur are of the view that it is recommended to be prayed once per lifetime. Yet, while verifying the hadith and its authenticity, it's a very weak hadith. So many of the scholars are of the view that we should not pray it because it is an ibadah. It is a ibadah that does not rely on a sound reference. That is briefly the difference of opinion with regards to Salatul Tasabih. Sister Asia from the KSA. For the grand iftar and the invitation and people come and they speak about the dunya and also that is supposed to be for a charity iftar, rather they only invite the rich people. Let me look at it this way. Since I just attended one of these iftars, we have to look at the purpose of such iftar. Normally, النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم said, من فطر صائما كان له مثل أجره. That is the main effective cause as why should we invite people for iftar or take iftar to people to break their fast on. Because النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم said, whoever gives a food, a meal to a fasting person to break their fast on, he shall get a similar reward to their fasting. Of course, without diminishing the reward of either one of them. So that's why I invite people. And that's why whenever I'm invited, I happily accept the invitation because I also want to benefit my brother by giving him the thawab of my fasting and my family and so on. Even though, you remember, I said from the beginning of Ramadan, I told my family, no visitations. Till today, we did not invite a person, nor did we accept any invitation. Because Ramadan is a very precious time, I wanted me and my family to utilize it in the best fashion. So I tell my wife that you don't have to cook anything, cheese, watermelon, any fast food, that's fine that you can do in half hour or maximum an hour, because you too, you need to benefit out of your time. And our children should learn that as well. It's a waste when somebody has been cooking for 3 days to prepare for a meal. If I can afford it, I would rather buy the food ready made. Why? Because the time is much more valuable than the money which I will spend in buying food or catering. Because I need to spend this time either in Quran or istighfar or in prayer or adhkar or resting in order to be able to pray taraweeh. I know that during these invitations, most of the guests, they waste the taraweeh. And obviously the host, between cleaning up after the invitation and taking care of the guests and so on, they miss the Taraweeh of a day or maybe even two. So this is a fact. Now sometimes it is required to hold such meetings to bring unity to the community, to bring people who do not know the community to get to know them, to invite non-Muslims to learn about Islam and see our traditions, such as a meeting which I attended a couple of days ago in Kuwait, where they invited ambassadors of non-Muslim countries and business people in order to show them their activities, and invited a speaker to address them about Islam. The topic was mercy to mankind. Give them da'wah. Meanwhile, rich people encourage them to donate towards their good causes, their non-profit organizations. So this has a reason. So when you say they have not invited the poor people, because the purpose is to invite people who can afford to pay so that this money will benefit the poor people. If this is the intention, that's perfectly fine. As far as the talk is mostly and mainly about the dunya, it is very unfortunate, but it is happening. And we cannot talk about the deen 24/7. We also talk about the dunya, as long as the talk is lawful. We're not involved in vain talk, in backbiting, in slandering anybody. We're talking about the dunya and the business. That too is permissible. You can be very ideal, but the reality is sometimes things like that, we have to do it this way. If you feel like, well, I would rather spend this time at home than go for Taraweeh and so on, you can simply excuse yourself and say, Wallahi, I'm busy that day. That's it. Barakallahu fiqh. But based on the benefit-risk ratio, these meetings sometimes are very beneficial, if it is intended, as I mentioned earlier. But other meetings, nowadays we have belly dancers in Egypt, they make iftar and they invite people, and singers and corrupt people. I would never go to such iftar because this food is haram. This earning is 100% unlawful. So do you expect that they will be talking about the deen? Or be talking nice talk? No, the whole setup is haram. So if you know who's the host and what is the purpose of the function, and if you can be of any help, this is also for the sake of Allah. Otherwise, say sorry, I'm busy. Brother Sharif from United Arab Emirates, he once entered a masjid and he prayed by error behind an imam whom he later on found out that he was an Ahmadi. Such prayer is invalid because they have no prayer. So if you pray behind them, we do not consider them as from amongst Muslims. Okay, a few years ago we heard that about such ambassador, American ambassador, fasted Ramadan in Pakistan. So what? Thank you so much. This is just another way of losing weight, but this is not fasting. Fasting comes after believing in the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To know why are we fasting? Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. It was prescribed for the believers. So if any person would like to join us in the masjid and see how we pray and copy and imitate, fine, but this is not a prayer for them. Okay. So this prayer you must repeat, Brother Sharif. You must make it up. His father is 78 years old, mashallah, may Allah give him a long life. And bless him, and bless him in you, and make you dutiful to him. Take good care of him, because he's the middle gate of heaven to you. If you seize this opportunity and be dutiful to him and be kind to him until he meets Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you've gotten your easy pass to Al-Jannah, insha'Allah Azza Jal. As a matter of fact, he doesn't have to fast, number one, since he's senile and he cannot afford fasting. وَعَلَى الَّذِينَ يُطِيقُونَهُ فِدْيَةٌ طَعَامُ مِسْكِينٌ. So the ransom is only the fidya, feeding one miskin per each day. Some of the scholars said, has he reached this age, then he's not even required to fast and he doesn't owe any fidya. I would say, Brother Sharif, pay the fidya in his state since he cannot afford it. It's all good. And a meal every day, or have saw, would not hurt. It is not a big deal. Ummu Amn from the KSA, whether went to Mecca or Medina, and you join the prayer missing a few rak'ahs. The hadith which is collected by Imam al-Bukhari, in which the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, فَمَا أَدْرَكْتُمْ فَصَلُّوا وَمَا فَاتَكُمْ فَأَتِمُّوا. In brief, it means, and this is the opinion of the vast majority of the fuqaha, when you join the imam or the jama'ah late, whichever rak'ah you catch with the imam is your first rak'ah. So you recite the Fatiha and a surah. Then after the imam finishes, you make up in the same order. You make up in the same order. You join the imam in the third rak'ah, that's your first rak'ah. In the fourth rak'ah, that's your first rak'ah. So what you do is recite in the same order, in the first two rak'ahs, al-Fatiha along with the surah or a few ayat. While in the third or the third and the fourth, you do not owe any recitation after Surah Al-Fatiha. Umm Abdullah from Cairo yesterday asked, and that is the only pending question along with the Anasheed, what are the responsibilities towards my non-Muslim in-laws? Treat them kind, invite them to Islam, show them the proper Islamic behavior. Every once in a while, address them about the oneness of Allah, give them da'wah materials, and that's it. You honor them also because of your husband. They are in your in-laws. Can I give sadaqah from my husband's money without his permission? If he gave you a general permission in the past, or if the sadaqah is something very insignificant, a few pounds or whatever, no big deal. You will be rewarded and he will be rewarded because the money is his. But if it is something major, then you need to get his approval. The anasheed, lawful anasheed, unlawful. Yani if the words are okay, the poem is okay, without musical instruments, then it is permissible to listen to such anasheed. Women should not sing in public whatsoever, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَلَا تَخْضَعْنَ بِالْقَوْلِ فَيَطْمَعَ الَّذِي فِي قَلْبِهِ مَرَضٍ. Brothers and sisters, we actually went over time. Until tomorrow, inshallah, I leave you in the care of Allah. Happy Ramadan to all of you. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Allah is my heart's speech. Your mercy is what I beseech. Keep in my heart your remembrance, and in your deen allow me to advance. Help me in my quest, permit me to pass the ultimate test. Help me in my quest.